Good morning, Mount Moriah. How is everybody today? Everybody good? How about this side over here? Y'all good? This side over here? Y'all even better? Amen. Amen. All right, let's be honest. We're in church. Who in here has had a hard week and you could really use some prayer? You are exactly where you need to be. Amen. Thank you for coming out today. We got a lot of people watching on Facebook Live this morning. Would you give them some applause and let them know you're glad they are here? Amen. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and share this with you. I'll get to the announcement in just a minute. Trunk or Treat's coming up, and so people are bringing candy in, okay? And a dear lady brought some in, and somebody else brought some. Says, I got something for you. And I thought it was candy. So I took it up to my office and I was inspecting it to make sure, you know, it was okay for the kids. Amen. Amen. And I opened it. There was a cup in it. And I realized this was a gift for me. And it says this. You're going to love this. It says, be careful or you will end up in my sermon. Thank you, Janice and Carol. I appreciate that a lot. That's what, yeah. Yeah, that's, you may get me Monday through Saturday, but Sunday is coming. All right, amen. All you deacons, all deacons that are here this morning, even if you're not an active deacon, I need to meet with you in the nursery right after this service. All deacons, active or inactive, please meet with me for just a few minutes in the nursery. Next Sunday, October 23rd, the youth are going on a bowling trip, okay? If you're in grade 6 through 12, if you have a friend in grade 6 through 12, bring them to church next Sunday. Be a part of this right after church. You're going to have a meal. And then you're going to go bowling, okay? Please, all you youth, remember that. Pink Out to Fight Breast Cancer, Sunday, October 30th. I know you're looking around going, I've never seen pumpkins quite this pink before. That's because we only grow them in Edneyville, y'all, okay? But this is just a decoration. It's a reminder that this is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And at the end of this month, on the very last Sunday, that is the 30th, we're urging you to please wear pink, okay? And a cash donation will be given for everyone who's wearing pink, and that money will go to fight breast cancer. And here, we've upped the ante this year, okay? If you have friends who are on Facebook or something like that, have them take a photograph of themselves wearing pink, send it to the church's Facebook page. A donation will be made in their honor as well, okay? We'll raise as much money as we can to fight breast cancer. I mentioned candy a minute ago. Trunk or Treat is the very next day, October 31st. We'll be gathering down in the parking lot like we have for years and years. We'll have 200 to 300 kids come through. Feel free to decorate your car in something nice and not too scary, please. And we want to keep it holy. And we're just going to have a wonderful time in Christ that night. If you're not available that night, bring in some candy. We always could use extra candy, okay? And thanks to everyone who's brought it in thus far. The golf tournament, Tom Pryor Memorial Golf Tournament, is Saturday, November 5th. That's one of the biggest fundraisers we do of the year for Phase 2, okay? And I've been saying it for a few Sundays. The drawings are being drawn right now. We've got something we're going to have to look at here and not too very far off into the future. But we need whole sponsors. We need players. We need gift cards, all that stuff. Please, if you'd like to get involved, see me after the service, and we'll get you plugged into the golf tournament. Shoe boxes. Don't forget shoe boxes, okay? Please pick up one or two or as many as you want. Fill them up. Bring them back and be a part of that ministry too. You may say, Brian, I don't have time to do all of that, but I'd still like to be involved. For $25, you can just write a check to the church for $25, write shoe boxes on it, and you can even specify, I want a 6-year-old boy, I want an 8-year-old girl, whatever you want to do, put it on there. We will fill the shoebox for you and make sure that it's passed around the world. Okay? Skylie and Brendan are still taking up money for just another week or two for St. Jude's. I've had two people ask me this morning, where's the St. Jude's box? Where's it at? Okay? It's right out here. As you leave, it'll be on your left. It's decorated. It's just beautiful. Please give to that as you see fit. Let's see. Coats, jackets, socks for the homeless. We're still taking those up. Bring those in as well. Amen? All right. I think that's all the announcements. That's enough announcements. Amen? Y'all remembered all that? If you don't remember it, there's one of these. Also out on the table out there, take it with you as you leave. It has a whole list of what I just told you. Okay? I want to turn our attention to the prayer list for just a minute. If you will, this week, be praying for Jackie Griffin. Jackie, we love you. We're praying for you. Joel McCraw, he's going to Duke, I think, in the next couple of days, and he's going to have his foot pretty much completely rebuilt. Be praying for Joel McCraw. Ashton Melton, a young cousin of mine. He's like 27 years old. He has leukemia. He's at Mission Hospital. Would you be praying for Randy? Miss Kay Smith, we're praying for her. Paul and Janet Vaughn, we're lifting them up. Connie Lauder is having surgery this Friday on her kidney. Please be praying for Connie. Angie Dixon, young lady with breast cancer. Please be praying for her. And last but not least, would you please be praying for my wife this week? She's having two back surgeries. She's hurt her back from carrying me all these years. Amen. No, on Tuesday, they will go in her side, and they'll be working on some discs, replacing some of those. Thursday, she goes in, they go through the back, and they'll be removing stenosis and bone spurs and putting in rods. She's going to have she needs your prayers. We need your prayers, and we would really appreciate that. Amen? How about an unspoken request this morning? I've got several. If you're able, would you stand up? Let's pray together. Lord Father, we come to you this morning, and we're grateful. We are thankful to be in church this morning, Lord Father. Thank you for putting the desire in our hearts and enough health in our bodies to be here today. Would you please bless us as we draw closer together and draw closer to you? We pray, Lord Father, that you would just help us, Lord. I know that many of us came in these doors this morning and we have burdens on us and we're worried about this or we're concerned about that. We're worried about someone in our family or just a neighbor. Lord, we all have things right now. And Lord, I just pray that over the next hour that you would help us to lay these burdens down at your feet and just focus on you. Let us magnify you, Father. We know that you are bigger than our problems. You are bigger than anything that we face. Would you please demonstrate that to us this morning? Show us your power and just bless us. Show us, Father, how blessed we are. Show us, Father, how loved we are. Father, just help us. Lord, we do pray for all those who are sick and afflicted, those who are hurting. We pray for the homeless. We pray for anyone in need. And Lord, Father, I pray that you would use us, your church, your people, to reach out to this world. Show them the love and care of Jesus Christ. Father, we pray for those who have procedures coming up, Lord, Father. Bless them. Lord, Father, we pray for those who are in nursing homes, end-of-life care facilities. We pray for them. Lord, Father, we pray for those who have lost loved ones in recent days and weeks, even months, Father. We pray for them. But Lord, Father, most of all, more than anything else, we pray for those who do not know you in a real and personal way through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, I ask you if there's anyone watching today via the internet or anybody in this room that needs to give their heart to Jesus. Lord, Father, let today be that day. Speak to us. Speak to us through the music. Speak to us through the preaching of your word. And Father, we're going to give you all the honor, praise, and glory for everything you do. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And everybody said, amen. 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 Let's praise this morning.
Can't see past myself, Lord, help me. Raised in church. We both come from a musical family, and I grew up Southern Gospel. And I know a lot of you, some of you can relate in here, and some of you are too young to relate to that, but this morning, Donna was gone, both Davids were gone. We didn't have a choir this morning because so many people were planned to be out of town at one time. So Mom and I did a duet, and His Eyes on the Sparrow is what we attempted to do. Some of you might know that song, some of you might not, but up on the screen is a sparrow. Look how small it is. And there's a scripture that came to my mind this morning. Brian, if you'll put that up. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them will fall to the ground apart from the Father. But even the hairs on your head are numbered. Fear not, you are more value than many sparrows. I don't know if you guys are like me, but sometimes I feel like what I'm doing doesn't make a difference. Sometimes you feel like you're just chasing your tail and you're not getting anywhere and you're being a bad parent and you're, you know, and sometimes I just need an encouragement to know that the big God of the universe loves me. You know, little old me. And of all the millions and billions of people, He cares about me. And it came to, I love that song because if He cares about a little sparrow that you could put in the palm of your hand, how much more does He care about you? And sometimes I just need to be reminded, I don't know if you guys do too, that I matter, that what I'm doing matters, that God's put me here for a purpose, and that I just need to be reminded that I matter to God, this great big God of the universe. And then he cares about every single hair on my head. That's just amazing. I can't fathom that sometimes. That he loves me so much that he cares if I lose a hair in my hairbrush. That's just amazing. So anyway, I don't know if you needed it, but this morning I need to be reminded just how much he loves us. Okay, we're going to sing our last song. Please stand up if you want to. If you can't, that's okay.
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes.
I can count the times I've brought you things on broken nights, and you showed up and patched me up like you do every time.
I get amnesia.
I forget that you keep coming around. Yeah, ain't no way never let me down, down.
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes, because I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs.
But tell me, is he good?
Amen. If that blessed you, say amen this morning.
Amen.
Let me find me a piece of furniture up here. There we go. That'll work. If you will, get your Bible, if you brought it with you. Go to Psalm 133. We were there last week. We're going to go there again this week. David paints us a beautiful, beautiful picture. Psalm 133. While you find your place, let me talk just a little bit. We are in the ninth and final week I think, of a series I've entitled That They All May Be One. Based on Jesus' prayer in John 17, where our Lord prayed just before He went to the cross. Just before He went to the cross, church, He had me and you on His mind. Isn't that wonderful to know? Just before He went to the cross, He prayed for you and me. He prayed that you and I, the church, would be united, that we would be one. And I know that some people are glad that we're at the end of this series, because a few of you have told me, Brian, it's really hard to be united. It's really hard to coexist sometimes, because we're human, amen? And people get on our nerves. Things come up. Disagreements happen. You can put two of the closest people in the world in the same room together. Within an hour, there might be a disagreement. Amen? It is hard. Jessica, quit hitting Brian. It's all that. And I know that at least a few of you are wondering, Brian, why are you spending so much, 9 weeks, why are you spending so much time on unity, especially when our church is such a close family? Well, let me give you a few reasons. Number one, I'm preaching on it because it's Jesus' desire, His last prayer, that we be united. Amen? That in and of itself is enough to spend 9 weeks on. It's Jesus' will. It's what He wants. Number two, Satan would love nothing more to come in here and tear this family apart. Do you believe that, church? It's true. Every time the doors are open in this church, Satan is trying to get in. He's trying to tear us apart. He doesn't like it when we're together. Let me make it even personal for you, more personal. He's trying to tear your family apart. He's trying to tear your home apart. If he can divide anything, it don't matter if it's a church, a business, or your family, if he can divide you, he can conquer you. If he can divide you, he can destroy you. Number three, the reason I'm preaching on unity for 9 weeks is because the world is broken. This church and the church shouldn't be broken. The church is the one place in the world where people should be able to come and go, ah, this is the way it's supposed to be. Amen? And number four, unity brings God's divine favor. Look at Psalm 133 again. Like I said, David is painting us a beautiful picture here. He says, behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Now, the way I just read that is not the way he wrote it. Do you see at the end of the word unity, there's a mark there. What is it? There's an exclamation point. What does that indicate? Excitement. See, too often we read the Bible in monotone. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for the brethren to dwell together in unity. That's not the way he wrote it. Amen? Now, that might be the way I preach it, but that's not the way he wrote it. He says, listen, it's really, really good and it's pleasant for the brethren to dwell together in unity. And there's nothing better. That's what he was saying. He says, it's like the precious ointment or oil upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard that went down to the skirts or to the edges of his garments. As the dew of Hermon, that's the largest mountain in Israel. It produces dew that keeps Israel, keeps them moist and gives them rain. Okay? The dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion, and there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. What David is describing is like a blessing of the Holy Spirit. It's like the Holy Spirit just being poured out upon us when we're in. Has anybody ever felt a drenching of the Holy Spirit? I have. It'll stop you in your tracks. It'll make you weep. It'll make you weak because you're in the presence of God. This is when you're unified. That's what it's like. It's like God's Holy Spirit is just pouring out upon you. Church, here's what the verse is saying. When God's people, you and I, when we're united, God commands, mandates, demands, make sure, however you want to put it, that we are blessed. It's His commandment. When we're together, we're going to be blessed. How many of you need to be blessed today? Amen. How many of you want your church to be blessed today? Amen. Then listen to this. Keep the unity. Keep the unity in your home. Keep the unity in your church. Work together. Love one another. Forgive one another. Serve one another. And you'll be blessed. Last week I gave you three blessings of unity. I want to go through them real quickly again, because I know some of you weren't here. Number one, this is a blessing of being unified. Unity defeats the devil. Unity defeats the devil. Listen, church, stick together. Like I said, pray for one another. Forgive one another. Serve one another. Love one another. And the devil cannot stop you. He can't stop you. Because God commands His blessing upon you when you are one, when you are together. That works here at the church. It works in your home. Let me take it even further. It works in your business, your livelihood. Stay together. But beloved, listen, beware. The devil will constantly fight your unity. He'll fight it because the devil fears nothing more than unified Christians and the power that God releases through you. There is power in you, in your church, when you are unified, when you're together. Number two, unity gets people saved. Unity gets people saved. Remember what I said last week? What you do in here determines what happens to people out there. It does. That's true. Let me explain. David says it's good and pleasant when we dwell together in unity. Do you agree with that? Say amen if you agree with that. People want to be where good and pleasant things are happening. Do you agree with that? Say amen. Well, listen to this. People talk. Communities communicate. We have something in Edneyville in every small community called the grapevine. Y'all ever heard of the grapevine? Okay, it's a means of communication. Okay, and it's real. People talk. And listen to this, not only are people talking, they know what's happening in here. They know what's happening in here. People in our community. I can go to the general store. People know what's happening in your church. I'm like, how do they know that? Oh, grapevine. People are talking. And listen to this. If they're hearing bad things, they don't want to come here. If they're hearing good things, they'll want to be a part of it. And who knows? Some good old boy or gal might just walk through those doors one day just to see what's happening. Because they're hearing good things. And when they come in here, they're going to hear the gospel. And they might just get saved. Amen? Unity gets people saved. Now, folks, let me take this one just a little bit further. I know this is just a review, but I was thinking about this past week. I was just driving along. And the Holy Spirit just convicted my heart. How many people do you suppose that you and I have turned away from the church because of our negativity toward the church? You ever thought about that? How many of us have ever been away from church and went, ah, the preacher's boring. The music isn't what I like. I don't like old so-and-so. It sits across from me. It was too hot. It was too cold. The sermon was too long. The service was too long. Be honest. Don't raise your hand. How many of us have ever said things like that in the presence of somebody outside these walls? How many people have we turned away from the church because of our negativity toward the church? Toward our church. Let me bring it home for you. How many of us have children or grandchildren who are now in their late teens, 20s, or 30s? How many of us? Amen. How many of those late teens, 20s, or 30s are not in church today? Ouch. Could it possibly be that they heard that same negative stuff? Ah, the preacher's stupid, and I don't like that music, and them people are idiots, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Could it possibly be because they heard that stuff from us on the way home from church every Sunday as they were growing up? Just asking. Are we killing ourselves? Unity gets people saved. Discord, disunity, drives people away from church. Parents of small ones, church isn't always perfect. In fact, sometimes church can get ugly. Amen. Don't feed your children all the negativity, because they'll remember it. Okay? Train up a child in the way they should go. Don't fill them full of negativity. And they might just stay in church. We talked about one more last week. Number three, unity removes fear and creates boldness. Unity removes fear and creates boldness. Folks, this world will knock us down and kick us while we're down. Anybody been there lately? Anybody? Yeah. I said it last week. I've had my tail handed to me a few times over the past few weeks. But there's hope. I get knocked down. This world kicks me. But God's Holy Spirit gives me the power to get back up. And I'm grateful. I'm grateful to God. I'm grateful for the Holy Spirit to pick me up. But listen, my church, you give me the encouragement that I need to keep going. The Holy Spirit picks me up, but you keep me going. I can come in here feeling so low, so bad, I don't even have to open the doors to come in. I can walk under them. Anybody ever been there? And I can come in here, and man, I see somebody smiling, somebody glad to see me, somebody give me a hug, a high five. Pastor, good to have you, man. Good to see you. Can't wait to hear the sermon. You just, man, I need that. And you can only find that here. You know, when I go to Walmart or Ingles, nobody high fives me. Not a one. Not a one. But when I come home, family, when I come home, I feel loved. I feel appreciated. Amen. And it gives me the will to keep going. It gives me the strength to stand back up and say, world, bring it. You can knock me down, but you can't defeat me. Unity removes fear and creates boldness. Now let me give you a few more blessings of unity and we'll bring this series to a close. Number four, unity keeps Christ at the center instead of us. Unity keeps Christ at the center instead of us. How many of you brought your voices with you this morning? Okay. Let's practice. Everybody say amen over here.
Amen.
Okay, let's try over here.
Amen.
All right. I'm not sure about y'all. Let's try it one more time.
Amen.
Amen. Most of y'all with me. Okay, I want you to humor me for a minute. At the count of three, I'm going to count down for you. At the count of three, I want everybody in here to shout. And it's okay to shout in church. The Bible says we can. Okay? I know we're Southern Baptists. We ain't used to shouting. All right? I mean, we can muster, amen, every now and again. But okay. I want you to shout your first name. On the count of three. One, two, three. That's a good shout. Much better than the first service. In fact, this is good. Let's do it again. One, two, three. You know what that sounded like to me? Disorder. Is that what it sounded like to you? Just a bunch of blah, blah, blah. All right, let's change it up. This time, on the count of three, I want everyone in here to shout the name above all names. The name of your Savior, Jesus. You ready? One, two, three.
Jesus!
Ah, yeah. Yeah. I can understand that. That was, one more time. That was so good. One, two, three.
Jesus!
Yes. Yes. Church, you know what you just did? You just demonstrated that unity comes from Jesus, not from us. Amen. He's what holds us together. Unfortunately, we live in a me world. Look at me. Listen to me. Notice me. Take care of me. Me first. It's all about me. That's the world we live in. And it's permeated the church. Church has become about me. Entertain me, take care of me, sing to me, preach to me, take care of me. The church shouldn't be that way. It's supposed to be all about Him. All about Him. After all, this is His church. Amen? I like to say it's my church. You like to say it's your church. And in a way, I understand what we're saying, but ultimately, it's His church. It's His. In fact, I feel a little funny when people, you know, I'll be out in the community and somebody say, well, we need to go visit Brian's church. I'm like, whoa, Brian don't have a church. It's His. It's Jesus' church. I just get to be a part of it. Amen. Church was not invented by a bunch of preachers 2,000 years ago who figured out, man, I know a good way that we can get a lot of fried chicken every now and again at a potluck dinner. That's not how the church was formed. Jesus established the church and said the gates of hell will not prevail against it. It's His. I don't know about you, but I can't stop hell. Jesus can. It's His church. Listen. Church is not about any individual, any group, or any family. It's all about Him. It's all about Him. I've said this a few times over the last 9 weeks. A great church is a we church, not a me church. And as long as this church is our church, Jesus will bless His church. Amen. It's about Him. It's all about Him. And as long as we stay humble and stay unified, then we're able to keep Christ where He belongs, in the center, not ourselves. This leads me to blessing number five. Unity keeps Christ in your church. Unity keeps Christ in your church. Here's a question for you. Do you believe it's possible for a church to exist without Christ? You're answering just like the first service did. You're saying, no, it's not possible for a church to exist without Christ. I submit to you today, folks, that it is possible for a body of believers to exist without Christ. It is. It's called a dead church. It's called a dead. You ever been to a dead church? I've been to a dead church. Been actually to a few of them. What's the old joke? At a dead church, if somebody was to die and they called the EMTs, they'd move 20 people out before they found the one that was really dead. Y'all heard that joke? Yeah. Dead church. Dead. I mean, doorknob dead. A church where there's constant disagreement, dissension, and drama. A church that's become powerless and ineffective because they're not one. A church where the Holy Spirit isn't welcome and God's not in it. That's a dead church. And they exist. They're all over the place. It's become all about me. It's become about programs. It's become about stuff and things we do and all that. And we've gotten so busy and so full of ourselves that we've pushed Jesus back. I've seen churches who have become so big, it's about them. It's about their name than it is about Jesus. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Listen, if God can command His blessing, God can remove His blessing. Amen? And there are churches out there where God has removed His blessing. He said, oh, you want to make it all about you? Okay, I'm out. Enjoy. Dead church. How many of you in here have more than one child? Amen. Do or did your children ever fight? Argue? Charlene, you had three of them. Did they ever fight? Did they ever argue? Yeah. Let me go somewhere else. Who else do I want to pick on? I done picked on Jessica and Brian. You got three of them. Two of them are twins. Did the girls ever argue from the beginning? In the womb, they were, yeah, I got you. They my boys did. I have two boys. They're grown now. But they would argue and carry on and fight. All of that. Marvin, your girls ever argue and fight? Just every now and again, once in a blue moon? Yeah. I found something amazing. I'd walk into the house and the boys, their bedrooms were upstairs. And I could walk in the house and you'd hear it. Blah, 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 blah. You ain't nothing but a blah, 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 blah. You know, just carrying on. I mean, just fighting. Just going at it. And I get it, that's what children do. They're immature, amen? They're self-centered, they're self-focused. But you know what's funny? I'm going somewhere with this. You know what's funny? I could walk into the house and go up those stairs and I'd hear blah, 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 blah. But when I'd walk into the room, something funny would happen. They'd quit fighting. You know why? Because they knew Daddy was home. They knew Dad was in the room. And they knew that Dad was Dad. Dad had the authority. Dad was in charge. Dad had the final say. They knew that. Can anybody relate to what I'm saying this morning? Have you experienced that in your own home? Amen? Listen to this. When a church constantly argues and fights, it's because the Father isn't with them. Did anybody just have a revelation? When a church constantly fights, it's because they're not concerned about what God wants. They only care about what they want. When a church is constantly at odds, especially over things that in the long run mean nothing, that lack of unity proves they're not in the same room as God. When a church is always fighting, it means that the Father's not in the room. They're just immature kids fighting with one another. You take a church that's fighting and you put God back in it, the kids quit fighting. Are you hearing me, church? Folks, when God is in the church will be unified. You show me a church that's full of discord and disunity, and I'll show you a church, the Father's not there. Daddy's gone and left kids to do whatever they want to do. Amen? Is that making sense this morning? Unity keeps Christ in your church. Now, for the past 8.5 weeks, we've been talking about the church as a whole. But listen to blessing number six. Number six, unity keeps the individual secure. It's talking about you and me as individuals. Let me illustrate this point with a question you might consider to be silly. Do penguins get cold?
Yes.
I have a yes. Do I have a no? Yes, I have a no, or yes, I don't. Let's vote. All those of you that believe penguins get cold, raise your right hand. Okay. All of those of you who believe penguins don't get cold, raise your hand. Okay. All right. Put the picture up for me, brother. That's a picture of emperor penguins. They're big ones. They grow to be about 4 foot tall. Big birds. Okay? They live in Antarctica, where the temperatures can reach 80 degrees below zero and winds can blow 100 miles an hour. Now, we had some cool mornings this week, and I had a toboggan and coat on. It was a whole 40 degrees, and I'm freezing to death. Amen? Let me ask my question again. It's 80 degrees below zero, and winds can reach 100 miles an hour. Do penguins get cold?
Yes.
All of those of you who voted yes, you're right. Penguins do get cold. Brian, what does that have to do with anything in the whole wide world? Here's the question. How do they survive those harsh conditions? Oh, man, y'all got it. You know what that's called? It's called a penguin huddle. Penguins do get cold, but they unite. They come together. It's so effective. Listen to this. Scientists say that in the center of the huddle, a penguin huddle, that it can reach almost 100 degrees. Yeah. In fact, listen to this. The penguins, you see the penguins on the outside? There's a good chance they've already been on the inside. Because they have to keep revolving. It's like a big conga line for penguins. Oh, you like that, huh? They do. They go in a circle and they keep circling and circling and circling until they get to the center. And then they circle back out because they will overheat. Okay? What they do is they keep moving to make sure that their brothers and sisters can get into the warmth. They don't want to hog it all for themselves. So they keep moving. Here's my point, church. God designed us to need each other. This world is hard. This world will beat you up. We need to huddle together, which is what we're doing this morning. We are huddling together this morning. We are drawing strength from one another. We're drawing security and safety, encouragement from one another here in our huddle this morning because tomorrow we got to go back out. We got to go back out where it's cold, where it's dangerous, where people want to hurt us. So we come in here to huddle. Over 30 times, the Bible makes reference to a phrase. It says, one another. Love one another. Serve one another. Encourage one another. Amen? Folks, we can't do what we need to do without one another. And I don't care if it's a church, a family, or an organization, a business. We need each other. We can't be who we need to be without each other. I can't be the pastor I need to be without you. You can't be the Christian you need to be without me. We need each other. You need each other. None of us are here by accident. We had a visitor in the first service. A man that visited this service several weeks ago. His name's Curry Tilley. Anybody know Curry? He's the associational strategist for the Carolina Baptist Association, of which we're a part of. He was here And I was preaching on this message, and I was preaching on church health. And he came up and he says, I can't believe you were preaching this on church health. That's what I live for. That's what I do. I said, there are no accidents. God wanted you here to hear this. He said, man, that's so good. You've been preaching on this 9 weeks? I said, yeah. He said, I'm going back through YouTube and Facebook. I'm going to watch the rest of this. I said, I'm not much, brother, but jump in, grab it, go with it. There are no accidents. You're here this morning. You might even be visiting, going, Brian, I'm just visiting. I'm just passing through. It's not an accident. God wanted you to hear what I'm saying today. You need each other. Families, you need each other. Organizations, you need each other. Church, you need each other. There are no lone rangers in this world, especially in church. Amen. Let me say this. We're better together than we are apart. That's the bottom line. We're better together. But Brian, I don't even like everybody in here. That's okay. They don't like you either. But we're better together. We're better together. God put us together for a reason. Someone once said this, the nearest thing to heaven on earth is a church full of people who love the Lord and each other. Right here, this is as close as we're going to get to heaven on this earth, is when we're a church family. Everybody say family. Family united in Christ. A number of years ago in Canada, we were talking about cold weather in the Antarctica. It gets cold in Canada too. One winter, it was a very harsh winter, a little girl, 2 years old, wandered away from her house. The parents are not sure how she got out. Have no idea. But she got out just before sunset. And they lived near a large, large field. Here in Edneyville, we'd call it a pasture. Huge acres of open field. And they called the authorities, of course, because they were panicked. They'd run through the field. They were looking for the little girl. They couldn't find her. They called the EMTs or whoever, whatever they call them in Canada. And ladies and gentlemen came out, and they looked through the field, and they couldn't find it. Finally, one of them, just before sunrise, says, we've got to call the neighbors. We need to call the community. We've got to get everybody together. We need to just hold hands, everybody, and let's walk through this field so that we can cover every square inch. They did. It took minutes. Hundreds of people showed up. Word got out. This little girl's missing. And they started walking across this field. And they'd walked about 5 minutes or so. And one of the men yelled out, I found her. It was too late. Her little body was frozen. She was dead. The man picked up the little lifeless 2-year-old girl. And he said this, oh, if only we had joined hands sooner. That describes so many families and organizations and churches today. They're broken. And only if they'd joined hands sooner, it'd be different. Church, I'm in a unique position. I do something that's very, very rare. I pastor the church that I grew up in. Do you know how rare that is? Very, very unusual. Most of the time you're not accepted. Jesus wasn't in his hometown. They run him off. But I've been around this church for 58 years, pastor 23 years, deacon 6 years. I've seen this church up and I've seen it down. I've seen good and I've seen bad. I've seen it when the altar's full and people are getting saved, and I've seen it when the church is so cold and dead that nobody's moving. I've seen it when there's lots of money to go around and times when there was nothing. I've seen it all. And we go, well, why would God do that to a church? He doesn't. We do it to ourselves. Because there are times when we make it about me, and there's times when we make it about Him. When it's good, He commands a blessing. When it's bad, He takes His blessing away. Now, He uses those times to teach us and grow us. That's a hard lesson to learn sometimes, being part of a dead church. Here's my point. Your church will be what you make it to be. That's what I've been preaching 9 weeks to say right now. This church, your church, Mount Moriah, will be what you make it to be. If you make it about you, God will say, fine, I'll get out of your way. But if you make it about Him, if you stay united, together, one, the devil can't stop you. The gates of hell will not prevail against it. It's in the Bible. Amen. Sister, come on up. Come on up and play for us. If you will, stand to your feet. I want to have an invitation. If you'd like to come up this morning to this altar, and the whole stage is an altar, if you'd like to come up and just pray for your church today, would you do so? I'm going to ask you to close your eyes and bow your heads right now. If there's somebody that wants to come up and pray for your church, would you move out right now? Would you come up? If there's somebody here this morning, you just need prayer. Like I said, the world's knocked you down and kicked you. Would you like to come up and pray? Come on. Pray. Maybe you need to pray for your family, your business, your organization. Would you pray? Come up. There might be someone here you need to rededicate your life to Christ. Would you pray? Maybe there's somebody here you've never given your heart to Jesus. You've never been what we Christians call saved from your sins. Would you come to me? I'd love to pray for you right now. If you just have something on your heart, a burden, a problem, a worry, would you come up right now? Lord Father, I pray for this congregation. I pray for this church, the people in it. Would you bless us? Would you help us? Father, help us to be united. Help us to hold one another up in this world. Help us to stay one. Help us to fulfill the prayer of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Help us to be who we need to be. Help us to do what we need to do. Just help us, Father. We love you, Lord. We love you. If you would, just keep your head bowed, your eyes closed. Let folks have their time at the altar. When I